This is awesome. Welcome everyone to the YouTube Space LA. We're so excited to have you all here, and we are so honored to have this illustrious crew with us here tonight. Right to my left, I have J.J. Abrams. I have a whole long thing, but you all know who he is, so I'll just skip that. To the left of him is Kathleen Kennedy. Whose accomplishments are mind-boggling. I just have to call out some of these stats because they're crazy. She's produced or executive produced over 60 films, which have collectively garnered 120 Academy Awards. Nominations. 120 Academy Award nominations, 25 wins, and grossed $11 billion worldwide. Yeah. Not shabby at all. We're gonna start down at the far left. We've got John Boyega. He made his film debut in 2011 in the hugely successful Attack the Block, which many of you may saw. He has since earned nominations in the Best Newcomer categories at the 2012 British Independent Film Awards, Critics Circle Awards, Evening Standard Film Awards, Jameson Empire Awards, as well as winning the award for Outstanding Actor at the 2012 Black Reel Awards. Not shabby. Yeah. Next, we have Gwen Christie. Lots of passion here tonight. This is great. She caught the industry's attention with her scene-stealing appearance in HBO's Game of Thrones. She is also starring in the final installment of the hugely successful franchise, Hunger Games: Mockingjay Part 2. And finally, we have Daisy Ridley. Believe it or not, this is Daisy's first feature film. No pressure at all. It's like, no big deal. Okay, so since the theme is storytelling, I thought we'd start tonight by just asking everyone, what's the first story that really inspired you, that really you connected with and kind of inspired you to be a storyteller in your life? We'll start down with John.
I would say from my parents and their journey coming to the UK, they came from Nigeria and decided to leave the Boyega village in Ibadan and set up a new life in the UK for more opportunity. And it was always, you know, quite strange for me to hear that story of how my mum and dad came to the UK with absolutely nothing and established a home, a family, and got us into school and got me into theatre school. And so for me, that story that he always tells me to remind me where I come from is something that I feed off of, and it definitely inspires me daily.
I remember watching a television program. I always loved reading books, and I loved watching television, watching movies. But I remember watching a film on television called Oranges Are Not the Only Fruit from a book by Jeanette Winterton. And that was, it had a big impact on me because it was about someone that was treated badly because of their sexuality and someone that decides to actually embrace their life and go their own way. And I was so appalled by the treatment of the woman, the young girl in it, that it really awakened my consciousness that there had to be a change and that this was an important piece of literature and this was the sort of work I wanted to be involved in.
Oh my God, my answer is so basic compared to that. I can't even remember what happened in the story, but mine was Sophie's Adventures by Dick Kingsmith. And it was about a little girl who was either from the city and went to the countryside. It was that it. And she like learns to ride a horse and goes to a farm. Like super basic. And I don't really know how it's inspired me, but clearly it stuck with me. So yes.
I got into a thing where I became very inspired by John McPhee. I don't know how many of you may know McPhee, but I think what McPhee writes about in terms of politics and nature and the importance of the world around us, and I would say that he was probably the most inspirational most recently to me.
First of all, thank you all for coming. This is awesome. A number of answers come to mind, stories that my mother read to me when I was a little boy. But the thing that struck me the most was Rod Serling's The Twilight Zone, and the stories that were told in that show, often written by Serling and some by Richard Matheson and among many others. But that show did the thing that just ignited this sort of passion for stories that were about character and about something that mattered, often very sad stories, frankly, but they coexisted with these great, mind-bending, often supernatural science fiction genre, and it was just an amazing thing to see drama told that authentically and that emotionally, and also have it be something that was hyper-real, and that to me was something that made me want to be part of that somehow. I also like Sophie's Adventures.
So let's get into Star Wars a little bit, the reason why we're all here. So a question to you, JJ, and you, Kathleen. The fact that Star Wars has been around for 38 years is crazy. How do you keep a story going and keeping fresh for 38 years? How do you do that?
Well, and we have to give a huge amount of credit to George Lucas, because JJ and I have stepped in and are relatively new to this, and clearly what George created with A New Hope was something that was extremely personal to him. It embodied a lot of things that were important to him at the time and continued to be very relevant to him, whether it was personal or political. He was really trying to mirror the things that were important to him as he was telling these stories. I think also what he was doing was he was making the stories very aspirational. He created characters that we could relate to, that had a sense of optimism and hope. And I think, you know, it's interesting, you look at a lot of movies today, and especially big blockbuster tentpole movies, there's a kind of, I find, a tendency toward nihilistic violence. There's a kind of relevant storytelling that edges into something that's not necessarily optimistic or aspirational. And it seems obvious that would be something that people would be attracted to, but it's not done very often. And I think that George seized upon something unique in that way, and I think that's why it's been a kind of mythology that people have carried with them. And one of the things that JJ and I and everybody involved in this saga are encountering is it's extremely important to people. I mean, they're looking forward to this movie in part because of what's come before, and they realize that it's something they want to share. They either want to share it with their family or their friends or just the community of going to the movies and experiencing something that does have this long history that continues to be shared. And we don't have very many things in recent culture that really do that. And I think that's a part of what's kept it going and certainly made it important to us in terms of carrying on this story.
I think that's 100% right. I think that one of the things I felt when you and I first talked about what this could be, and you came to me to ask if I'd be interested in working on Star Wars, which happens all the time. And And my reaction was, at first, no, because I felt I had done sequels, and I thought, you know what, I kind of care about it too much. And but then we sat down and started talking about it, and it was so clear so quickly for me personally that I wanted that feeling again. I just wanted something I had not felt since I was a kid, and it was a feeling of unlimited possibility and incredible potential and a world in which characters that I love that made me laugh and relate to, that they would have experiences that they could never have dreamed of at the beginning of the story with other characters who became as important to them as family. And the world that George created was so vast and so full of possibility that our very early discussions were so, it was such fertile ground, and it was really at the very, very beginning more of a feeling. And all I could tell you is, without being strategic about it, I knew that if I had that feeling to return to this place, not to return and tell the same story, or not to return just for the sake of nostalgia, but to return to a place to tell a brand new story, which really became the, not the mandate, but the sort of directive, I guess, for this movie, which was go backwards to go forwards. And it really was true in the design, in the scripting of it, in the music of it. I mean, to listen to what John Williams has done, taking some of his original themes and then, you know, creating these brand new ones and finding how they coexist. When he conducted the end titles music for this movie, and it begins the way they always do, and it went into one of the themes that you'll hear in this movie, it was this inevitability, and of course it's what we're all trying to do at every turn, is honor what we've inherited, this brilliant world that George created, and do something that is new, while at the same time adhering to something that feels in our gut distinctly hopeful, distinctly special, familiar, distinctly Star Wars.
So I'm gonna... And that's why it's so special right there. I'm gonna pick up on something you just said, going backwards to go forward. And a lot of our creators deal with this, where you have a really intensive fan base that really expects something from you. And how have you dealt with, Kathleen and JJ, developing a new narrative with a really intensive pressure from a very engaged fan base? How have you dealt with that with the Star Wars franchise?
Well, I think it's fairly basic. We sat down recognizing that this was a huge responsibility, not only to ourselves, but to the fans and to the company that had bought Lucasfilm, that we had a huge pressure, obviously, to find people who we could...
$4 billion.
So you can sit down and sort of say to yourself, okay, that's just too much, let's just not do this. But I think every single one of us, when we started to do the first thing JJ asked us to do, which is we had these big whiteboards in this room, and he said, why don't we start by everybody just writing down what they want to feel? Just that basic premise. What do you want to feel once we create whatever this story is going to be? And it was, I feel it was fundamentally the best question he could have asked all of us, because that's where the conversation began. And just as you said, going back in order to go forward, we needed to recall for all of us what that was in order to know where to begin.
I'm gonna shoot it over to you, Gwen. You've played some really strong characters in a lot of very big franchises, some of the biggest franchises in the past 5 years. How does that, what pressure does that bring for you in creating these strong characters in these franchises that people love so much versus clean slates where no one's expecting anything and you have a fresh palette?
Well, I'm not sure first of all, that I've ever really thought about the question you've just asked me.
Is that good? Is that a good thing?
And now I've started to think about it. I'm experiencing a lot of emotions. But really, I don't know. I mean, it's a character, and so you go about your work in the same way that you would do for anything. But I am now thinking maybe I should just be thinking, what do I really want them to feel this at this point? Mm-hmm. I'm sure that would make any performance of mine a lot worse.
We're here to help. We're here to help. John, you've played some pretty exceptional characters, and one of the biggest attributes or things that people relate to with our YouTube creators is authenticity. It's kind of the cornerstone of our platform. How have you been able to maintain authenticity when you're building characters that have nothing to do with your authentic story?
I think there's a level of research. It doesn't solely just happen with me. With this process specifically, I have to say thank you to JJ and Kathy, because even though the auditions were so long and I came back over 9,000 times.
It was a gift. It was a gift.
Yeah, it was a gift. But it allowed me to explore and collaborate with JJ on a character that I knew nothing about. And you know, going in, no one received a full script, and the sides were decoys. And it was good to have JJ there to give me notes and to spark a conversation about somebody I didn't know. And so, in terms of authenticity, I felt like, you know, through the notes, through obviously Kathy's guidance, it worked out organically. So, but for me, it can't just happen with me by myself. A good director is always good. JJ, I'll be in touch.
Daisy, so you are new to the scene. What characters have really inspired you and made you what you're bringing to this film?
God, I sound so basic tonight. My favorite film is Matilda. But it's funny because being in this film, obviously, Ray can't make jugs of water tip over, but I see the parallels with Matilda and Ray. I think, like, I love the film so much. She's a little girl. She's, like, you know, not loved as she should be. She doesn't quite fit. And she finds this incredible potential and, like, makes jugs of water tip over. Like, it's amazing. She makes a little girl fly. It's just joyous. And when she begins, she has no idea of her potential. And she goes on to do amazing things. And at, you know, the end of the film, it's not like she's this whole different person, but she's found love because of it. She's found acceptance. And she can make a book fly to her when she wants a bedtime story. So, yeah.
We're learning a lot about you. JJ, a question for you in how you thought about directing. But we have all heard George Lucas say that 50% of the film's story came from music and from sound design. How did you think about sound design as you were creating Star Wars?
Well, you know, when you look at the original movies, it is mind-blowing how much George got right. Meaning, you know, any one of the amazing accomplishments in Star Wars would have probably made it a kind of unbelievably memorable, kind of perennial film, but the fact is, it's the plot, the humor, the heart, the adventure, the visuals, the design, the visual effects, the music, the sound effect, like, checkbox, 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 like, everything was unbelievable. The silhouette of a TIE fighter, the sound of the TIE fighter, the music when a TIE fighter flies by, they're all amazing and they're all happening at the same time. That's the sound of the typewriter. When you hear the you know what Ben Burtt came up with for sound effects, when you listen to the music of John Williams, it's as important as anything. And as a kid who grew up before you could download a movie or rent a movie, I could only listen to my vinyl soundtrack. of Star Wars, and I would lie on the floor of my room with my headphones on listening to the story, not just the cues, it was the entire story told to you through music. And if you wanted, you could look at the titles of the cues to remind you where you were, but you didn't need to, because John just told you the story. And it is an incredible thing, whether it's in these trailers or in the film itself, in moments when someone stops. There's this one little moment when John and Daisy are together, and they stop, and they hear this thing, and it's that scream of a TIE fighter coming. And you just hear that, thing. And you just if you don't know what it is, because you haven't seen Star Wars before, you lean in. But it's again and again and again, there are these testaments to the power of the audio in the movie. So we were very much aware in scenes what the music would be doing. And it's almost like cheating working with John Williams, because he's just from another place, and as kind as he is talented and brilliant. So it was something that I've been aware of since 1977, and have never had a chance to harness the specifics, of course, of what Star Wars brings musically and in terms of sound effects. But it was something that almost every scene was heard for, I think, all of us as we were working on the script or working on in rehearsals or shooting, knowing how critical that was going to be in every scene, every step.
Yeah, certainly some of my biggest memories are the sounds. Yeah,
it's incredible.
Kathleen, I can't leave this panel without asking you this question. You're such an amazing role model for women in this industry, and there's been a lot of discussion about how we empower women more in this industry. We've got a lot of female creators in the audience tonight and across the planet. Cheers to our female creators in the audience. What advice do you have for young female creators in the world today? What of all the things you've learned, what would you tell them?
Well, I think tenacity is everything. Don't give up. If you have a good idea, keep at it. One of the things, and I will just mention this, at Lucasfilm, the executive team is 58% women. 4 out of the 6 developing these movies are women. And it definitely, yep. It definitely changes the conversation in the room. And I think if there's anything, and it's great to hear that there are so many women in this company, and the fact that there are a mix of voices in the room, already you're ahead of the game. And I think that when you don't realize the difference, and I've sat in a lot of story meetings and conversations where often I've been the only woman in the room, it's quite different when there's more of a balance. And I think that there will be much better stories told, and I think stories that we don't even know about today will be told, because it's coming from a different point of view. So you have something to say, make sure you say it.
And I think that female perspective probably lends to my next question for you both again. But how do you manage the human aspects of a story like Star Wars that is so draped in sound and visual effects and the grandness of the story? How do you manage the human elements? How did you make that come to life in Star Wars?
Well, I'll say that knowing that this was going to be a Star Wars movie, and knowing that meant there would be, someone who I work with said that Star Wars is like a Western. That if you're gonna make a Western, there are certain tenets that you're gonna have in a Western. And they listed all these things, and it's amazing how many of them there were and how true it was. And in Star Wars, there's gonna be a good versus evil fight. There's gonna be good guys and bad guys. There are gonna be lightsabers. There are probably gonna be TIE fighters and X-Wings and Star Destroyers and all those things that you want to see. those things are amazing. We also knew we were going to have, for example, the Millennium Falcon in the film. And when we were on the set of the Millennium Falcon and we were getting ready to shoot and we were, you know, setting up the cameras and we were doing the scenes, it was never more clear that all that stuff is incredible. And just some of the greatest toys and the greatest... But if you don't have the story, if you don't have the characters, if you don't have the direction, the point of view, the drive, the conflict, the right dialogue, if you don't have the stuff that matters in every story, it won't work in a Star Wars story. And I know it's so obvious to say, but I keep realizing the more I work that the most obvious things are the most important things. And it's never too late to be reminded of the stupid, obvious thing. And so working with Larry Kasdan, who is the genius writer and an icon for me, Larry Kasdan, ladies and gentlemen, who wrote Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi and Raiders of the Lost Ark and directed amazing films, Big Chill and Body Heat, et cetera. To work with him alongside Kathy and to get to talk about not just sort of what ifs, but to hear from him what he was thinking when he came up with Yoda, when he wrote the great scenes with Han and Leia, when he was, you know, working on all sorts of moments that were these seminal moments for me as a kid that he came up with. And it was a wonderful thing to have his soul, his heart, his brain involved in talking about the continuum. And everything that we talked about was about trust in the characters and trust in the audience. Don't explain everything. Be efficient. You know, he was always talking about finding ways to tell a story in the most sort of in a look, in the most succinct way. And he loves Westerns, and so it was a perfect kind of an analogy, because so many of the great characters in Westerns were so well defined by so few words. So it was all about these characters. And once we had a handle, all of us, on who we wanted to tell a story about, and literally by saying to ourselves, okay, yeah, forget Star Wars, forget, just say, this is a story about a young man who, a young woman who, tell the story, just tell the story. Once we knew that, all the other things that we had written on these lists that Kathy refers to, things that we were dying to see, started to become clear how and where and when we could use and incorporate ideas that we were just desperate to see after so long. And it was all to serve the master of the heart and soul of the characters. No one cares about the amazing spectacle if you don't care about the characters who are there and experiencing it. And one last thing, and then I'll shut up, it's a long answer, sorry, is a lot of times I'll do this stupid little thing when I'm doodling. I'll draw a circle and I'll shade it so it becomes a sphere and give it a little bit of a shadow. And it just, it's always just this little sphere. It's a ball on the floor with some light. But then sometimes I'll just draw a little figure next to it, maybe one that's kind of climbing on it and then one that's on the top. And what's incredible is there's this feeling I suddenly have about this stupid doodle. It goes from being this object that means nothing, that alludes to dimension and is just a sphere, and it suddenly becomes something that, because there are these little figures there, it just starts to feel like there's almost like a little, there's a story going on. There are, and you realize that as long as you have a character interacting with something that is potentially interesting, it can become interesting. That character's got to work, you know, there are a lot of caveats, but you need to have that perspective. Just having the sort of God's eye view of spectacle is something that, when you look at Star Wars, it almost never does. It's always about the experience that the characters are having in that spectacle, and that's, you know, one of the many lessons that we learn by looking at those films.
Awesome. Yeah, that deserves a round of applause. So I think we're gonna shoot to a couple questions from the audience. We've got, I think, time for about two or three audience questions.
Hi, Hi, okay. Do you think this latest addition to the Star Wars saga will captivate the younger audiences of today like the original films?
And maybe start by introducing yourself.
Oh.
Yeah.
I'm Vanessa Merrill, and I have a twin.
Well, I have a twin.
Kathy's a twin as well.
I have a twin.
Oh, cool.
I'm going to head in and answer that from my point of view, because I wasn't hugely knowledgeable about the Star Wars universe. I'd seen the films, I was engaged with them, but that was kind of as far as it went. And not just because I'm part of it, but watching the film was like thrilling, so thrilling. And to be one of the few people who it hasn't impacted hugely, but I also think to be part of more people now than before, a new generation of people who maybe aren't so in tune with it, and to still enjoy it as incredibly much as I did, I think that is testament to the film and how many people it's going to appeal to.
Okay, I'm Brennan Taylor. I have a question, like, what goes into writing a story for a film that's as prestigious as Star Wars, but basically starting from nothing at the same time?
Well,
we could be here all night.
I mean, the answer is, and I sort of alluded to this before, but beginning, as Kathy said, asking ourselves, what do we want to experience, what do we want to feel? Then Larry Kasdan had this one sort of mandate, which
you
is...
You have to do them. Can you do them?
All right, I'll do my impersonation of Larry Kasdan, which is so good. Oh, my God. Okay, this is how Larry sounds. Like, if Larry were here, this is exactly how he would sound. So he talks about, like, wanting to... his one mandate was just be like, the movie's got to be delightful. It just is got to be great. Like, not too much talk. You don't need talk. You just got to trust it. It's like, what the f*** are you talking about? Once you learn how to speak Kasdan, it's great. It's a fantastic thing. But we literally the movie had to be delightful. That's the thing that Larry was saying. And it didn't mean it had to be happy all the time. Delightful can be when you're just, you know, in shock, when you're devastated, but you're in a world. You've been taken to a place. And we literally just spent weeks and weeks and weeks walking and recording our conversations. And then finally, when we thought we had enough, went back and began on whiteboards to put up what we thought the movie would start to look like. And it was just like any process that you or anyone would go through working on a story. This just happened to be a Star Wars movie, and it happened to be a collaboration with the guy who wrote two of them. And it was always surreal. And one other thing I'll say is we had Rick Carter, who is the production designer, involved in the story conversations. And one of the things that was so great about that, and it almost felt like a little bit of a, almost more the way animation typically works than live action, which is to have production design materials being generated as we were talking about the very early seminal beats of story. And we could look at things that Rick, who is a dreamer and a beautiful soul, he would go off and he would hear something in the conversation, and he would go off and work on some things and bring back images of things that we might have forgotten about. And he'd say, no, remember you talked about this. And he'd show us these images that often opened up paths to things that ended up in the film that might not have otherwise. So it was just a kind of unbelievable creative process. I'm done.
Yeah, and you know, the interesting thing is, when you say that you're going to start out trying to do this and you have a goal of how long this is going to take, in our case, we suggested that we could do this in a certain amount of time, and we reached a point where we weren't going to make it, because this is an inexact science. You don't sit down and say, we are going to write a story and we're going to have it finished by this time. Sometimes things kick into gear very quickly and sometimes they don't. And they just take a longer period of time. And that's what we encountered. And we needed to go into the studio and say, okay, we're not going to be ready. We have a fairly clear idea of where we're going, but we need more time to get there. And yeah, we pushed the release date, which, as you can imagine, pushing the release date on something like this, that was a big deal. But obviously, we felt that we had to do what was right for getting the movie and the story where we wanted it to be. So That's also part of it. And sometimes you head down a path where it can happen very, very quickly. I made a fairly obscure movie called Diving Bell and the Butterfly. Thank you. And that was a situation where a book that was not an obvious movie and relatively difficult to figure out where the entry point was, I gave it to a wonderful screenwriter named Ron Harwood in England, and he was very excited to do the screenplay. And about 2 months into the process, he called me up and he said, I can't do it. I can't figure out how to do this. And then 48 hours later, he called me and he said, I've had an epiphany. I know how to do this. And within 2 weeks, he wrote the screenplay that ended up being what I showed Julian Schnabel, and it's essentially the movie we made. And you don't know, in the creative process, you don't know where that's necessarily going to come from.
Hi, my name's Tara Quick. I'm from Geek Conquer. One of our favorite things was always the practical effects, was watching the puppets on the screen. When you came into this new one, especially with some of the stuff that we've had in the past, how much did you concentrate on the practical versus anything that's CGI? Did you really try and go into the school of thought, kind of like with Guardians of the Galaxy, where they used a lot of practical effects and built upon it? Or did you kind of have a little bit more of a 50-50 balance? And then in regards to the actors, when you were using the practical versus the CGI, which was more fun? Which did you have more fun with, you know, using your imagination against a green screen or being able to do a little bit more of a physical thing with practical effects?
Thank you for the question. When I saw Star Wars as a kid and those two droids were walking in the desert of Tatooine, it was real. That feeling was so profound and happened again on Hoth, you know, in Empire, and it was something that Kathy and I, at the very beginning, were like, we need this movie to look and feel and be authentic. And so we immediately said, we're going to be building a lot of sets. We said, we knew, of course, there would be a ton of CGI, and there are, you know, 2,000 plus visual effects shots in the film, but we knew that there would be a ton of visual effects, and they needed to have a standard to live up to. And so we shot in Abu Dhabi, we shot in the forests of Wales, we shot in Ireland, we shot plates in Iceland. It was something that on the Pinewood Studios, we used all their outdoor space and built these fairly massive outdoor sets in addition to all the interiors. So that was really important. The characters, we had Neil Scanlon, an amazing creature effects shop, and Neil and his team built up dozens and dozens and dozens of unbelievably spectacular creatures, which showed us just how far practical effects had come, not just CG, but also with servos and remote control and latex for a different silicone for skin, the ability to create creatures that look so much better than they ever had. We had, for the droids, BB-8 is one of the stars of the show, and BB-8 was a puppeteer. Brian and David puppeteered this thing in almost every shot in the movie. There are a couple distant shots where he might be CG, but almost every shot in the movie, he was there. In the scenes where Daisy's character and John's character interact with this droid, he was there. And so you got to see a friendship develop between these characters. These two actors here are good enough, the two who interacted with BB-8. There are no scenes with Phasma and BB-8. But all three actors are so wonderful. They could have done it, and it could have been fine. But what happens is, every time you start to fake something else, it's just one other step removed. And the more you can get on camera, so we use CG quite a bit to remove puppeteers, to remove rigs and pulleys and wires and things. And what was incredible about that is, you looked at the film, and I don't know if any of you saw the stage production of War Horse, but if you did, you know what I mean, the puppeteers vanish. And you're watching this living, breathing creature, and that's what happened again and again on the film. And it was a critical piece of the puzzle for the movie to look and feel as it does. And I'll let you judge if it works. But that, to me, was the big thing. And I know that Kathy and I, from the very beginning, shared that idea.
I would just go on from that and say that is precisely why it was so fun. Because, like, when you see BB-8, like, he could roll out here because even within a year, the technology has become so much further that he can now move by himself. Like, he is really there. Like, there are two incredible puppeteers making him breathe, making him emote. Like, it was unbelievable. When we weren't shooting and they let BB-8 go, it was horrible. It was like, where's his soul? So, absolutely, working with real things was unbelievable.
And one other little teeny thing, which is in that first trailer we had where you see BB-8 for the first time racing across the sand, and he kind of looks at the camera and keeps going. That was in Abu Dhabi in 125-degree heat, and Brian, the puppeteer wearing a green jumpsuit, was dying, running, pushing him along the sand. And then we thanked him by painting him out.
I actually think John should talk to you about what it's like to be in a stormtrooper uniform when he's standing in 124-degree heat.
Thank you, JJ. I love you so much. it was quite the experience. I mean, one of the things that was so profound to me was working on set and walking towards the set and seeing something in the distance. First, I saw smoke, and then I saw debris, and then it was a full-sized TIE fighter crashed in the sand in the desert. I nearly peed in my stormtrooper suit. I was just like, this is actually real. And you know, another one of the moments where I thought to myself that the practical effects and having things there affects the scene so positively is that when me and Daisy, you've seen in the trailer when we're running from these TIE fighters, and me and Daisy were stood there, and JJ came out and was like, Daisy, John, so we're gonna have you. Run from here to here, and yeah, that's scene. Great. Okay, thank you, JJ. And then JJ backed up a few yards. Then he backed up some more. And then the cameras got protected by some plastic. And I looked at Daisy, I was like, this is about to be real. And we ran, and these explosions, you know, it was flying all over the place, and BB-8 was right next to us, and it was like, we are legit running from TIE fighters right now. This is the best Halloween ever. It's the best. So thank you, JJ, for practical effects, mate.
That's amazing. Thank you so much to our panel. Huge thank you to everyone. Please, we have a behind the scenes featurette, so please stay and learn and connect. But huge thank you to everyone here. Yeah.
Thank you.